Thank you. Yeah, I'll just use this podium only, I think. It's damn weird being on the other side of this stage. Really, really strange. I get a perspective of what the artist feels like when the audience is too far away and all that. It's exactly the same. Cool, so I just wanted to touch up on, to be very honest, like I've told most of you guys, I haven't really prepped. This is supposed to be a general Q&A session to what most of you guys go through on live shows. And I get a lot of these calls sometimes after the shows, sometimes a few days later, about so-and-so equipment and so-and-so artist and this happened and that happened. And I try and answer most of those questions like to the best that I could. But for some reason, it always seemed like there was never enough time. So I wanted to actually use this session specifically for engineers. And I know a lot of y'all in the room have called at some point or the other. So I want to touch on that, number one. Few other things I want to touch upon is just, it's been now about 15 odd years that I've been doing this, about 2 years that I've been doing it properly. The remaining was not so good. But like, I just want to touch up on some of the experiences I've gone through and basically how I end up approaching a show a day before, a couple of days before. How I end up approaching shows once I'm in the gig, gauging audience, gauging to an extent sometimes like the psychology of the performer, psychology of the audience, etc., etc. So I know a lot of people ask me what's my basic setup at the moment for shows. So let's start with I'm not too when it comes to an event, I'm not overly particular of exactly what PA I get, exactly what consoles I use. I more tend to approach it from a point of view of, I like to first know what the venue looks like. So I'll always ask for a AutoCAD drawing or some kind of a drawing that gives me some kind of perspective dimensions for a venue. So I don't necessarily have to go to the venue, have a look at the venue, you know, then kind of plot stuff. So I'll get an AutoCAD drawing, I'll look at it, I'll spec a PA, I'll spec console positions, I'll spec all of that, but also I will mark it on the drawing. It's not a very expensive thing to do. I mean, you need to have, I started out with a cracked copy of AutoCAD, now I have a proper copy of it. I'd suggest a lot of people invest in AutoCAD. Even as making your presentations to your clients, it comes into very handy rather than have a a piece of paper with something scratched and scribbled on it. Something professional like an AutoCAD drawing with speaker stands marked and positioned exactly where you want, console position marked exactly where you want, stage layout, stage design marked exactly where you want. Makes a lot of difference because 9 times out of 10 you'll come to the venue, then you'll find the scaffolding towers are not in the right place, the console position is not in the right place. So you can get rid of a lot of this nonsense by just doing a little homework prior to the show. It doesn't take more than an email or a phone call to get all these kind of drawings. Secondly, at the moment, my console of choice is either the Digico or the Midas stuff, wherever I can get it. I seem to be able to get it much more often than I used to. So any of the range of the Digico consoles is what I'll use, or the Midas Pro 3, the Pro X, wherever I can manage to find it. I now carry along with me a Waves server, an Extreme server. I carry along an MGB from DigiGrid, which is basically an interface between the server and the console. And of course, the plugin licenses. I find very often after a show, I get a lot of engineers or basically young kids that want to come and see what's been done on the console. And the first question they ask me is, we want to see your plugin chain. And they find it extremely strange that when they actually have a look at the plugin chain, there's almost nothing there. There's very little, very basic stuff. It's only what I actually require. That for some reason, whatever console I'm using does not do. At the moment, one of my favorites is a plugin by Waves called PSE, Primary Source Expander. I tend to do a lot of the shows, some of the new Bollywood shows, which have 5 singers, 6 singers sometimes, all singing together. they will have a full rock and roll setup along with maybe a sitar or a harmonium or a tabla, you know, so that it's a great tool to basically clean up all your sound on stage. You don't want bleed from the drums in the tabla mic, you don't want bleed. You'll get it. The way to minimize it is using this plugin called the PSE. I don't have most of my demo kit right now because most of it is set up in the high-tech audio stall down there. So anyone who wants to come and see my actual workflow, my plugin chain, etc., everything is set up there with a few multi-tracks. We can go through stuff there. Secondly, I find most, there's one thing you need to remember with using plugins on any desk. Like when you work in the studio, say on a Pro Tools or on Cubase or something, all of them have a certain amount of latency management for all the plugins that you end up using. To get that same kind of latency management on a desk is a little tough, and it's different for different desks. It's a little tricky to do it. It's the most straightforward on any of the Avid desks, but it's a little tricky to do it on any of the other consoles. Now, what guys don't realize is, supposing you have a standard setup of a kick-in, a kick-out, a snare top, and a snare bottom, and now you've loaded up, say, X number of plugins on the kick-in, and you've loaded 2X on the kick-out. Simply by inverting that phase is not actually going to align them anymore. Because firstly, they're out of phase, and then you've added X amount of milliseconds or samples in latency using those plugins. Now, the only way to actually calculate, and I've seen this on a lot of shows, that basically they have both mics up, but both mics are now fighting with each other because they are technically completely out of phase. You'll be lucky if they are in phase, but it depends entirely on your plugin chain and the amount of latency. Now, the only way to do that, and it's another tool that I use quite often, is Waves, there's a plugin that actually lets you align two signals. So you, was that in phase? In phase, correct, absolutely. In phase live. So the only way to now physically align those signals is actually by listening to it, which is kind of possible if you have a kick in and out, but it's almost impossible if you have like a guitar mic and a guitar DI signal. You'll spend a lot of time aligning and listening, and every half a millisecond here or there will change what the thing sounds like. The only way to align something like that is using in phase. The fastest and the only accurate way to align something like that is in phase. And same goes with your kick drum mics, your snare mics, and sometimes even your toms. Something that I do now, specifically for the drums, is that I tend to align the overheads and the tom mics to my snare. My snare becomes my center of reference. And specifically if it's like a jazz or a blues show, I don't want to go crazy gating stuff, where I want to leave everything open. So I know that snare is going to bleed into the other mics. I know it's going to bleed into hats and etc. So I generally do a little time aligner, slight time delay on the tom mics. It's something that you can try out. It adds a specific character to what the snare sounds like coming through a tom mic. And those delays are minute. They are in fractions of milliseconds. But I find on shows like that, I think the last time I'd used this was on the Mumbai Drum Day, the show that had happened at Andrews, so 96 odd channels of drums. And you can get away with it by, you know, EQing and kind of gating stuff. But I found this method of actually delaying minute delays in the toms to work much better, because it seems it's almost like I can leave everything open. And I don't necessarily need to gate too hard, because everything sounds much more in phase to me when I'm listening directly. So I think in phase PSE is a must get. I think for most applications, you can pretty much use it on absolutely anything. I have the entire PSE chain down in the demo room, so everyone's welcome to come and check it out there, and actually listen to, say, an open harmonium mic, which is like reasonably close to a drum kit. And what that does with maybe the 10 instances of PSE in and the 10 instances of PSE out. It's almost like you've added a certain number of ambient mics on stage, and that ambience really comes out. You're like, your definition and the clarity of your mix tends to go away. So any, I mean, questions, just, I don't want to talk too much because I know this was that Q&A thing. So any questions just regarding some of this stuff, plug-in chains, anything else you want to know about the kind of equipment that I carry around for my shows? I didn't carry around a lot of my own mics now, because I know sometimes my 58 will sound better than a vendor's 58. Depends on how many times that 58 has fallen on the floor, how many people have spat into it, how many people have been talking to it with pan in their mouth. It's, with lipstick, yeah, oh man, the lipstick thing is, like, and I've had instances when I've handed a cordless mic to an artist and he was like, have you tried this? And I was like, no, I mean, I just tested it. Can you smell this? He's like, and I'm like, yeah, it smelled of some cherry flavored lip gloss. And he's like, can you just take a wet wipe or something, clean out the grill? And I mean, that's funny, but that things like that happen very often. So I tend to carry around SM58, Beta 58 grills. They're available extremely cheap on Guitar Center and Musician's Friend. Even on Amazon, you can buy them. It's just cleanliness, because if I give the same mic to an artist that I'm traveling with later, I don't want him necessarily having someone else's. And it's just bizarre. It's bizarre to me. So, and they, I mean, they kind of take a little pride in the fact that I go that extra step to do that for them. It's something that you can just approach most of your artists, the guys that you're dedicatedly traveling with. Try and get accessories which you can change around on their mic or whatever. So that's meant only for them for that day of the show. Yeah, so that's about the basic stuff that I do with my live stuff. Now I use this kind of setup with Amit Trivedi very regularly. And I try and save time when I'm doing other bands which are in the same channel list kind of thing as him. I'll probably use the same file. I find it pointless to get into making a fresh file because I have one file that's really well dialed in. I'll use the file, I'll change the names of the singers, whatever I need to change, and pretty much end up using the same file. So this is another thing you guys can approach. Don't waste your time. With this advent of digital technology, don't waste your time working harder. Work smarter, because the digital technology allows you to do that. Any questions just with regarding to this this basic setup? Any of you guys that have come for shows that have questions regarding how stuff happened there? Nothing, silence. RF. And I think a lot of people, you don't really get into RF issues when you're in India, because most of the RF bands are reasonably left open unless you have some kind of government or police presence or chief minister coming for your show. On the flip side, when you're in a city like London or in a city like New York, I can almost guarantee if you carry generic RF equipment from this country or from anywhere else, without programming for frequencies, without programming for open frequencies, you will have an issue. I faced this several times in a lot of cities, and this has actually led me to invest in my own set of RF and RF planning gear. There's a little very cheap box. It's available on multiple of these electronic sites called RF Explorer. So it's a small little handheld device. It comes with two antennas. One antenna is for radio frequency, and the other antenna, which I don't really need, but is for 3G and 4G, which can actually also pick up 3G and 4G frequency ranges. My typical start to any event where I know I'm going to have RF problem, and I know now places in India, venues which are close to TV stations, extremely close to radio stations, and I know there's going to be some kind of political police kind of presence there. The one thing you need to realize, whenever there's a political or a police gathering, they always tend to carry signal jammers, so that basically when their cats are there in the place, they leave open only their frequencies, and to an extent try and block and jam most other RF frequencies. And the reason for that is most of your remote controlled explosive devices, whatever, are all RF controlled. So they will leave open their VHF or UHF frequencies, which they might be using for their walkies or, you know, whatever equipment they have, but they'll almost do a blanket ban on all other frequencies. And so you'll have a show going great, and you'll have a chief minister walking and suddenly 16 frequencies are off. No one can hear anything, microphones are freaking out, etc. Now, one way I've found to combat this when I know this might happen is to actually find out what frequency bands. It's a little difficult to get this information, but if you have a promoter that's kind of reasonably strong with the administration or police or whatever, they can manage to give you a frequency band. These guys are carrying walkies in this particular frequency band. I will make sure that when I tune for my frequencies using RF Explorer, I'm nowhere in that band at all. So on RF Explorer, it basically works on a Mac, on a PC. You open it up, connect to USB, it will do an RF sweep of the entire RF range. So it'll do from 300 and something, it'll do up to 1 point whatever. It'll scan the entire range and it'll give you spikes where RF is already present. You import that. Now, if you remember, all the softwares, again, they're not very expensive. The RF Explorer is some $200. The RF Venue software is free. And once I have this graph in RF Explorer, I'll import it into either a Shure wireless management system, wireless workbench, or I'll import it into Sennheiser's wireless management system. Either of the two will accept this file. And now once you know X amount of bands, X amount of frequencies are used in the area that you are, you let Shure decide through the software which frequencies it needs to use for its RF. The entire thing takes maybe not more than 10 minutes to do, but you can be almost sure that your RF, to an extent for the show, will be pretty strong. Once you deploy those frequencies to all the transmitters and receivers, as it might be, a very important thing is to leave all transmitters on. So if you're using mics, you always leave the mics on. If you're using in-ear monitors, the in-ear monitor transmitters are on by default. That simply ensures that that frequency does not become available to anyone else to scan and capture. So, but if you're in like a London, for example, I've been in shows where we've needed some 40 channels of wireless. And once we do a scan in that particular band, we'll find maybe 5 free frequencies. Everything else is taken. Then your RF guy needs to specifically go in, manually check frequencies, what their kind of dB level is, which is free, which is not, manually load those frequencies into your device. It's something that you won't come across too much in India, quite rarely, but it's something I can almost guarantee when you travel abroad, you will come through issues like this. So rather than rely on someone else to do it, the best way to do it is to just learn it yourself. It's there's more than enough information on Google. No one in Bombay, at least, who has RF equipment will say no if you want to go to the warehouse, set up the RF equipment, and try this out yourself. But I think it will be a big benefit for everyone to get on this RF, not be scared of RF and not be scared of mics cutting out and in-ears cutting out. That's almost impossible if the RF is done correctly right from the start. Any questions regarding this stuff?
You may get like the frequency bands that they're using.
Yeah.
Now their jammers are blocking everything else.
No, the jammers sometimes they don't end up blocking everything. They end up blocking that frequency band and they end up blocking like half a band or so above and half a band below. So everything in that range stays pretty clean. So their communication, their ambulances, their fire trucks, their security detail for the chief minister, everything stays completely open. So that the main reason for them doing that jamming is to leave their number one is to leave their communication open, and number two, to an extent, to kind of, I think if it's a very high profile thing, if maybe a prime minister or something is there, to jam more frequencies so that you have RF controlled devices which cannot be operated without any detail.
Yeah, but wouldn't the jamming be like a broad spectrum jam outside of the frequencies that they are using?
If they end up doing a broad spectrum jamming, then that's going to be a problem. A And that's almost something that you cannot, you can be prepared by selecting frequencies out of their range and hope that that will be kind of safe, which most of the time works out. But I've not come across a situation yet where I've had it once a while back, and I learned basically after that. And the rule, generally for them is they will block their walkie kind of frequency range, and they will block about maybe another 500 above and a 500 odd below. So it'll kind of, you need to take care of two things. Number one, the RF equipment needs to not necessarily be like an A, B, C, D band, which is actually blocked by them. Because if it is blocked by them, there's actually nothing you can do. So you need to have RF equipment that is kind of outside of that band. And that's why you'll find a lot of vendors actually in Mumbai, for example, will have RF equipment from multiple ranges. And I don't know if it's specifically for this reason, but it can be, because very often you'll go to a venue and you'll find A band being blocked for whatever reason, and you'll find B, G, E, etc. will be completely open for frequencies. And I think that's generally also the way that they approach things internationally. Like, I've had one instance I remember in New Zealand. I think this was Shankar Mahadevan. Like a minute, this was a regular concert just before the show. We're having RF issues only on his mic, and we scan 3 or 4 times, and it just, the worst nightmare is when that scan comes up with no available frequencies. Because at that instance is when you need to have something like this, where you can actually manually see frequencies that are open and manually dial in those frequencies. So I think that experience, and the other one, which I think was in Ahmedabad, if I'm not mistaken, really got me to get this RF kind of act together. I won't use it most of the time, but if I know there's going to be an issue in some place, I would definitely, it's always in my rack to an extent. RF. I want to also touch up on active passive antennas, or is that like going too crazy? Or maybe you can do that like separately down in the high tech booth. Any more questions regarding RF, regarding plugin setup, regarding my console kind of setup and stuff? Voice over IP on Wi-Fi channels.
Sennheiser already has something that does it. I don't know if anybody's actually.
I'll tell you one instance. There is. I was doing an install in Bandra at this shop called Treasury. Trini, I think, implemented that install. So what that actually did, that was actually not over. Actually, that wouldn't qualify. That was not over Wi-Fi. That was over broadband. So I don't think I've done anything of voice or voice over Wi-Fi. Was that over Wi-Fi or was that broadband? That was broadband, yeah. That was broadband.
Might be worth harassing somebody at Sennheiser just now.
What's that?
Might be worth harassing somebody at Sennheiser to find out.
Might be. Go down to the Sennheiser store and find out about that. Audio over broadband, I mean, I've done quite a few times. It works really well. So just to give you an idea of this install. So they had an Ethernet network all over their 4 floors of their shopping center, and they were doing a launch on the terrace, but their music and playback system was in the basement, and they were like, we don't want any more wires, we don't want any cabling, we don't want any, nothing, like everything has to work, just, you need to make it work just the way it is. The thing that they had is they had a gigabit LAN running through the entire shopping center with switches, etc. And actually, even forget the software we use. It was a free software which we downloaded for Mac. One side is a transmitter. What is it called?
Soundflaw.
So Soundflaw is a software. It comes in 2-channel, and if I'm not mistaken, in 8 channels, transmission and reception. And it just sits on your computer as any other sound card. It'll just recognize it as a sound card. You take Ethernet out from a machine up or down, one becomes a transmitter, one becomes a receiver. And it's amazing. It just sends pristine audio through your broadband network. I've never done anything over Wi-Fi before, and that's quite interesting. But audio over broadband, like we've done a few times, it works out quite well. And that's actually not something really new, because you technically, like the sound grid network, for example, wave stuff is audio over broadband. That's all it is. AVB is also to an extent audio, not exactly over broadband, but it's a similar kind of protocol. So it's something that's been done for quite a while. It's strange that there are free softwares to allow you to actually do the transmission and reception of this. Never be afraid of searching for free softwares. That's something I've learned. Before investing in something, type audio over broadband free, and I'm sure three or four options will pop up. And this is something I end up using for anything that I want to kind of research. Always find something free. If you like it, then buy it. If you need it, buy it. Please stop using cracked plugins and all that nonsense. Just pay for your softwares. In the long run, it works out much. It works out far better. Even if it's something that you really, really need, if you find yourself using it every day, just go online, pay the $49, $50, whatever it is. Or when it is on sale, buy it for whatever it is. It's definitely worth it. Any questions regarding this?
Well, sorry, question back to your the plugin thing, what you're talking about, the in-phase.
In-phase.
You were using in-phase live for your, say, drum alignment of drums,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But now in-phase live allows you to move signal later,
yeah,
not earlier.
Yeah.
So if you're doing it, say, between your snare and tom,
yeah,
you were...
No, so on snare and tom, mostly I'll use in-phase. I'll dial it in a little bit by ear, but I can use it on in-phase itself. So I'll use it on...
Which of the two channels are you moving later? Because if your reference channel is the snare...
Reference channel is the snare, yeah. So I'm actually moving the snare. I'll move the toms just slightly out so that basically... So my snare comes here and it comes slightly out of phase when it hits the toms. So I'll actually move the toms one cycle behind. So it actually now comes in phase.
In phase live allows you to bring it earlier?
No, I will move it later. I will move it. So, for example, say my snare is something here, and by the time the snare is seen at the tom, it's seen maybe quarter of a cycle later. So I will actually move that tom by a few samples so that it comes in line with the next snare peak.
No,
three quarters of a cycle, exactly.
No, which basically means that the snare is your...
the snare is my reference.
The side
it
chain.
Will come to the... Yeah.
The snare will be fed to the on the side chain.
Will be fed, yeah. So okay. Basically your snare is coming first. The tom, the signal of the snare on the tom will come later.
Got it.
So because I can't move the snare, I'm going to move the tom by a fraction, and that fraction is in samples probably, just so that it hits the next peak of the snare. It's it's a little annoying. Sometimes it's okay for one show. It can be a little annoying for different shows because every time that little sample peak is going to change, depending on how the drummer is placed and stuff. So the good thing I find with in-phase is you can do it on the fly. Even once the show is on, you can capture on the fly and you can actually shift it once the show is already happening. So that's the... I find it the most effective though on when I'm breaking my head over a guitar DI and a guitar mic signal. I don't know why, but for me, I found that the toughest to do to, like I'll get it right, but then I move it a few samples here, it'll sound nicer, then I'll move it a few samples before, it'll sound a little different.
Obviously this comes last in your plugin chain.
This will come last.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
Because you need to assign a line for all the other latencies which are in the chain first. And then you put this last. Talking about this, another plugin that I really use quite often is Waves Tune Live, Tune Real Time. It's a great plugin for, well, just to give you an example, it will capture and retune in a space of about 1.5 odd millisecond. I usually don't, if it's a show that I'm regular on, I'll save snapshots because I'll change the actual key and the reference for each plugin that I'm using per song. But if it's something that I don't know, I blindly put it in chromatic, and I'm not too I don't have it too drastic, so it's extremely transparent. And a few of the artists that I've actually used it in prefer now that they run through it even when they're singing on stage. I'm not saying that they shouldn't be singing in tune, but I'm saying on stage, situations sometimes, depending on how your monitor mix is, depending on how the front of house is interacting with the stage, can sometimes be a little dicey. It's just reinforcing their confidence that they are singing in tune because the plugin is there to actually hold it in place. Reinforcing their bad habits is another way to put it, for sure. For sure. So tune live, if I need it, sometimes I'll wait for a couple of songs, see how it's going. If I see that the plugin is not doing much, I'll end up turning it off. On a day when it is doing much, I'll leave it on. I think between these three, I have the Mercury bundle, but I end up using mostly these three for everything. I don't really find, on these desks, I don't really find the need to use anything else, to be very honest. I think specifically, I don't like to use too much else because I don't like then having to, the desk does a latency calculation, and I know it's reasonably accurate, but there are times when I can hear like a parallel bus completely out of phase because that latency issue is not sorted. So you need to go about things slightly differently. So you need to make two and three, if everyone comes down to that route, I'll show you on the file there. Just dealing with latency on non-Avid boards. Because the Avid stuff, the one thing they really got right was their waves integration and their latency check was really done well. So other desks, you have to go about it a slightly different way to order to do the same thing that Avid does. Okay, I wanted to move on to things like dealing with artists, because this is something that I get asked also very, very often. I get phone calls saying, man, I just can't do this show because the artist is an idiot and they just don't listen to what I have to say and et cetera, et cetera. And it so happens that at some point or the other, I've worked with most of these artists, and it very often happens that I get a call from the artist a few days later about the situation. And then I get to know about basically how the engineer has conducted themselves on that show. It's happened several times. It happened with a lot of the young engineers. And I think that's definitely, you guys need to understand that to an extent that artist depends on you for what happens or what the audience listens outside. There's a way to communicate stuff without sounding rude and pompous. And I'm only bringing this topic up because I've got this kind of feedback, not only from artists, I've got this kind of feedback from a lot of vendors, especially the small city vendors. And they're like, you know, after doing all this, the show just did not really sound like anything. It was quite a mess. I have guys wanting to align subs and tops with like a 60 hertz tone. And I don't know how many words to tell you that that's absolutely incorrect. You cannot align a sub and a top with any kind of tone based on how loud the peak gets, because that only aligns it for where you are standing. It doesn't align it for 3 feet away, 3 feet in the front, or 3 feet at the back. So when I see people do that, if you want to get into aligning, and this is something I'll talk about next, is the need to buy or the need to invest in softwares like Systune and know the technology and the way to go about aligning systems. Okay, talking about getting back to this artist point, I suggest just approach situations where things become confrontational. For example, an artist might have some kind of effect unit which has a lot of reverb on it, and you don't necessarily like that reverb, as someone just asked me before this thing started. Don't just go up there and say, like, you know, just get rid of this reverb, it sounds like shit. No one wants to be told that their equipment sounds like shit. Okay, and I know a lot of people approach it that way. Go up, maybe sit down on the floor with him, you know, wear a pair of in-ears or headphones like he's doing, sit and tweak it with him. If it's not working out there, make some kind of a attempt to go back to their studio or whatever. Sit in the studio, tweak it there. Think of all the artists you're working with as basically the way you kind of work or what you earn, etc. Is if the artist did not call you for whatever reason, you guys would not have work. So don't approach it from a point of view of you know, don't get offended, don't bring your ego and all that nonsense in the way. This is a service industry like anything else. It's a service industry like, you know, if a waiter loses his temper with a customer in the hotel, he'll get fired. You know, so don't, there's no reason, we all do this job because we really like it. If you ask me to go for a drive somewhere and, I don't know, go sit in the heat and drink some coffee or something, I'll probably say no. But you go and ask me to set up a system in the heat, I'll probably say yes. So think of it, we are all in this job because we like doing it. I don't think if you do not like this kind of sound line, I don't think anyone would last in it. There are a lot of guys that have come that have done it and have decided it's not for them. Yeah. Any questions specifically regarding this? Anything specifically regarding stuff like this? I guess I just want to point on the fact about temperament, politeness, and just a way to deal with situations when you're in a live show. Before the show, during the show, after the show. I find a lot of guys arriving to a show and then realizing they don't have the equipment they don't have for the gig as per their rider. And this is with no communication to a vendor, no communication from the artist side to the production to nothing. And I find that, I can't believe, when was the last time I went to a show without having done at least 1 week of groundwork before getting into that show? So that when I walk in, I know exactly where my speaker towers are, I know exactly the equipment that will come, I know exactly everything that, I'm not surprised. A lot of guys that go into shows without knowing what equipment they're getting, or just expect the equipment to come as per the rider. That does not work in India, it does not work anywhere in the world. I'm sorry to say. So please make those calls to the vendors. Send an email, get stuff on email, on messages, on WhatsApp, whatever you have. The last thing you want is to get onto a show and then have your equipment not there. Okay. So I want to touch up on tuning and system aligning. I think I know just of a handful of people amongst the freelance bunch that actually have invested in like a SysTune or a Smart and actually use it on a daily basis. And I think it's because now if you're doing only front of house, you have a monitor guy and everyone to do something else, your only job to an extent is to make sure that that PA just sounds great. And you can do that to an extent by ear, but there are a lot of things that your ear will not tell you that a software and a basic RTA mic, I'm not saying invest in anything fancy. My rig is a Focusrite 2i2 sound card, RTA 420 mic. So the sound card is like, what, $6,000-$7,000, the mic maybe $6,000-$7,000. SysTune is expensive, but I used SysTune for the first 4 months free because I kept registering it on a different email ID just so I could figure the software perfectly before I spent, I think it was 400, 500 euros to buy the software. And I didn't know if I was ready to put down that investment for it. So I use it on my email ID, on my wife's email ID, my business ID, just to use it. I use it for a good 4 months. Okay, yes, I know what I'm doing. I think this is beneficial for me. I bought the software. And I'll give you very simple examples about this. I was doing an event some months back in Bahrain. The whole thing behind that is gain structure. So when you pull that fader up to zero, or in some cases, maybe minus 10, in some cases, plus 10, whatever it is, why can't you just leave the faders at zero and just change your gains?
But then, so in case if I have stuff being recorded as well, so that'll affect.
If you have
that.
What, sorry?
Like if I have a digital recording going out from the console,
yeah.
So it'll affect that as
no,
well, right?
Why? The digital recordings will mostly go pre-gain.
Okay, cool. So if I have, cool.
Your
cool.
Digital recordings, if you do like a multi-track recording for any of the digital consoles, you can set them to top of channel, which is pre-gain. You can set them post-gain, and you can set them pre-fader, post-fader also, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
So, and see, that kind of minute change in your gain, it's the same as bringing your fader up and down.
True.
You know, so my thing is, the thing is not about having the faders up at zero, to be very honest. The thing is to establish a gain structure from the moment you start checking the first instrument. Generally, how I like to do it is I start always checking the softest. So I can get a decent amount of gain on that and start bringing up everything else then pretty much around it. Another good tip also I'd like to say for bands that have like rock stuff, in classical stuff, 3-4 singers in the same band, always check the vocals first. Place the vocals on stage where they normally might stand. Check all your soft instruments, if you have tabla, if you have all your percussion, whatever, check them. And leave all those channels on before you start the louder stuff. Because the only way you'll figure out how much bleed is actually coming through all those mics is if you leave them on during that sound check. So you'll end up then having nice and pristine tabla and dholak and flute, etc. You've muted them and now you've checked your drums and your drums sound fabulous and now you've opened your flute mic and you can get 3/4 of the drum kit coming through that flute mic. So always approach it from, if you realize in the live scenario, everything does not, the mix as a whole needs to matter. No one cares how good the snare sounds. Okay, everyone will, the first thing is how great that vocal sounds. So if you don't have that vocal down and decently enough above the rest of the mix, you can pretty much forget about, no one is going to compliment you on how the snare sounded, to be very honest.
So you start
if the vocal is not sounding good.
So you start with the vocals and then
I start with the vocals. Yeah, my current thing is to, so I'll do my sistune bit. I'll then bring the lead vocal mic. The lead vocal mic, I won't check it on any other mic. I'll check it on the RF mic or whatever that the vocalist is using. I'll bring that to the console. I'll bring it up. I'll listen to it. I'll do a few hello checks. I'll make a few modifications. Maybe if it is naturally sounding a little boomy, I'll do a little EQ on the master just a bit. Rest of it, I'll just EQ on the channel itself. If I have 4 singers, I'll copy whatever I've done here to the 4, so at least my starting point is there. So if I know if they capture them, if they get a mic in the hand, my fader is up, I know it'll be heard. Once, I think the biggest kind of circle you get into is once you finish checking everything and your whole band is playing and suddenly your vocal is drowned because you've not taken this whole gain structure and setting up the gains correctly.
Thanks a lot.
Cool. That's an amazing question, and I'll be first on record to say that all keyboard players should be banned from using volume pedals. Have to be banned from using volume pedals. There is no reason why you need a volume. Okay. Sometimes you require a volume pedal, but and I make it a point when I'm mixing monitors specifically. After a few songs, there's nothing really to do other than watch whatever's happening on stage. I'll notice that now sound check time, the volume pedal was here. And during the show, the volume pedal is somewhere there. So you've probably cut your volume down by quarter, half, and then suddenly the singers can't hear keyboards and the keyboard player can't hear keyboards. And then I have a habit when I see that happening, I will never turn up gain. I will actually go there and make them get their volume back from the volume pedal back to what it was when we soundchecked. So again, there's a way to approach that. I can't be offensive about it. I have to just go there, tell them politely, listen, during sound check, you know, the pedal was here and now it's somewhere here. So just get it back there and I think everything will be sorted. And I think you won't even realize sometimes they themselves don't realize where exactly that pedal is because your focus is here. Your focus is not on exactly where your foot is. So you point that a couple of times, I'll point that out and like, oh yeah, okay. And the pedal will go back up. Suddenly everyone can hear keyboards again. I find it happens most often with keyboard players. I don't find it happening so much with? Guitar amps now, okay, sometimes.
Usually dholak players, no? They won't play and then they'll start playing it loud.
Compress, my friend. Compress.
But that sounds pretty different then.
It sounds different, but I'll tell you there are some guys that just perform really well. And there's just no way to put all the musicians in the same category. Because there are some guys that are brilliant at what they do. They will play, and I'll give you an example of the Sonu Nigam band, for example. They will play exactly in their sound check like they will do for the show. They will not play up, they will even go so far as playing the part that they are playing during the show in that sound check at the same velocity. So from that point of view, I know what you're talking about, because when I sometimes go out from that band or if I'm working with someone else, suddenly I've checked everything and then the show starts and like half the things are like, you know, double the volume sometimes because everyone is now just starting to smash. So that a lot of that comes from discipline, and a lot of that discipline actually comes from getting out of this monitor wedge situation and getting on the in-ear monitor bandwagon, because there you can always adjust yourself to be in a sweet spot when you have a monitor. You cannot adjust yourself when you have in-ears on, because then if you are playing loud, you are playing too loud, your ears are going to start getting. So I find a lot of them on in-ears tend to be a little more disciplined about stuff like this.
There is a question about phase thing. A lot of engineers now started putting subs on aux feed.
Yeah.
And usually what happens when you tune your system and you make your tops with subs in phase, it is at a particular crossover point. But when you use aux fed sub, and if you are using an aux fader to increase or decrease any, the sub thing in your bass, suppose a kick drum, you are increasing it using an aux fed fader. What happens? It changes its crossover point. Then again, it goes out of phase.
See, it does not necessarily change the crossover point. What it is actually doing is adding a minute number of samples because of the extra path that it has to travel. So your signal is now traveling to, for example, a channel. It's traveling to the aux, and then it's traveling out. I don't necessarily think it changes the crossover frequency as such. But if that's the way if that's the way the artist or the engineer is going to use the system, I don't know, and it's quite contested. I don't generally send like a pink noise signal from the software. I send it from the desk, so that I incorporate for the latency of the desk, also.
Usually, it is said that if you use on-off switch for aux fed. Whichever instruments is going through aux.
Yeah.
That's a better proposition than using as a fader. But a lot of engineers, they keep preferring to use fader rather than using
the
EQs.
No, the thing is, you're just putting it through a fader so that you have, like there may be one song where I actually want to boost a lot of low end on maybe a track. That track is sub-heavy, for example.
That then changes the crossover point for that.
Yeah, but you have to understand it will change your response even if you add EQ from the EQ of the channel. It will almost do the same thing. Because any kind of filter that you get into any digital system will always alter certain characteristics of that signal. I'm not sure it will necessarily change the crossover point. That's something I'll have to actually check. Running it inline and then running it through an auxiliary. But it will definitely change the, if you've tuned it at a certain sub and top ratio, it'll definitely change that ratio. And I think I get to know what you're talking about, because now suddenly you have a lot of sub running through the system. That in comparison with the top has to an extent changed the crossover point slightly.
Directly, how important is it to get it exactly in phase?
I find it quite important for the kind of shows I do. If I'm doing an Indian classical thing, I won't bother. I won't even use subs probably.
But then again, phase is different
It depends on the show, yeah. But if I'm doing a rock and roll show, there are certain instances in certain parts where I want massive amount of subs, maybe on my flow toms. Just if there's some kind of part that I know that's coming up, I don't want to necessarily do that with EQ. I just want to flip the auxiliary and add a little sub to it. And it's not that I'm changing it right through the show. I'm changing it like maybe for 2 seconds during a show and bringing it back to the level that it was. I don't think it's that drastically audible, if that's the right word. But something we'll have to definitely check and do some research on.
One more question. If you're using a very large scale venue, large venue production, then how do you push your subs to the extreme end of that venue? Because it's very difficult to put subs for delays.
Why?
But then it is omnidirectional.
So?
So it will cancel the subs coming from the front speakers.
No, but your subs are 150 feet away, supposedly. So your delays are 150 feet.
Okay, so if it is far field, then only.
Yes.
Otherwise.
For all of you, whoever went for the, I didn't go for the Justin Bieber show, but I got to see the setup there. And every single delay tower came with subs. They were all, all of them were running cardioid in certain sections.
Okay. Just so it has to run cardioid. That is what it is.
Not necessarily. I think running multiple clusters of cardioid subs basically just smoothens out the overall low frequency response around the venue, as opposed to running omni. I'm not a big fan of cardioid, but I prefer running my systems in omni and having control over how much sub I end up using. I think the cardioid stuff, if it's not done correctly, can give you a lot of, if it's honestly not done correctly, it'll sound great where you're standing and you move 3 feet or some little bit away and suddenly you'll have no subs at all. So unless it's done correctly, unless you are doing it yourself, and the only way you can do it yourself is again by having a measurement system so that you can actually gauge sub across the venue. There's actually no other way that you can do that. And you can actually gauge by changing delay times and you'll actually see delay responses kind of changing.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Yeah.
Regarding the alignment of speakers, alignment of speakers.
Regarding, sorry?
Alignment.
Element? Alignment. Sorry, okay. My fault.
Do you normally do alignment for the stage monitors with the PA speakers?
I wouldn't say I have never done, but I've started doing that for if a singer is using in-ear monitors and wedges. I will delay that wedge by a bit.
Only for the in-ear monitors?
Yep. Just slightly.
Okay.
Firstly, that's the wrong way to go about it. Using both in-ears and monitors is almost never works.
Okay.
And that thing of having one in-ear here and one monitor from here, you can forget about it.
Okay.
And think about it just logically, because you're getting one direct signal and you're getting one signal which is about 4 feet of delay, depending on how far the speaker is. It's never going to work. It will always, the more you start asking for more wedge, suddenly you'll find the in-ear is not enough, you'll ask for more in-ear, you'll start asking for more wedge. Get the artists into only using in-ears, using the wedge as a backup, if at all, which now I think most artists are on that thing. And if they're not happy with in-ears at all, get them to use the wedge and use the in-ear only as a backup in case they want just a little more, maybe top-end clarity or whatever.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Fali. Three quick questions. Does it make sense of time aligning your in-ears with respect to your main PA? While your artist is probably in certain setups when the PA is quite far off from the stage.
Not necessarily. That's just getting too anal about it. You can, but it's like, you can never do that because the artist can be anywhere on stage. You know, they can be backstage, exactly. Front stage, doesn't matter.
Right.
That is not something to really get into.
Second thing, during certain indoor gigs, what I've experienced is you tend to, when like certain places which are not acoustically treated well, you tend to get a bad slapback.
Yeah.
Because your audience is large, you're pushing your speakers too high. Certain people have given suggestions of the only way to avoid a slapback is just push your speakers really hard.
Certain people?
The vendors who suggested me. So does it make sense?
No, it does not make sense. Think about it logically. What do you want to do? You don't want the speaker firing into the back wall. So when it is rigged, all bumper frames, array frames of speakers come with angles that you can actually angle them up and down. So say, for example, Renaissance is one prime example. It's a crappy sounding venue. It's a big venue. And most often you're standing right at the back, 150 feet from the PA system. So the spec over there is you have your scaffolding towers or whatever for your speaker. But I will align my main PA to about 3/4 of the room. Okay? I'll align the topmost box to finish 3/4 of the room, and I'll have a set of delay speakers at the back. So that will cover up the remaining quarter. And the delay speakers might be maybe 2 VRX, something small like this. Just to fill up the HF and just to get a little more HF clarity at the back. And again, never try and not leave them straight. You know, you can even angle the speakers in a bit. Try and like know where the meat of the audience is going to be, and fire your system to that meat of the audience. If people are standing at the bar, they're not really necessarily interested in watching the show. So why should you pound them with sound at the back?
Makes sense.
And one more thing about this. A just these indoor venues, I know most of them start out full. Within 10 minutes, sometimes everyone's at the bar or having food and there'll be like 100 people in the front. What is the point of just blasting that venue when there are 100 people standing in front of your center fills on the dance floor? It makes in situations that actually end up bringing the house down and maybe in fact just increasing the center fills just a little bit so they get a little vibe over there.
Makes sense. One last question. Could you just run through what is Fali's way of approaching a gig from say a week back when he's given the gig?
Oh shucks. My way is to do as little work as possible. I'll go through my selection of show files. I'll see which show file kind of makes the best use of what show I'm doing. I'll edit the channels there. And I pretty much carry my same rig. So I'll have the server, I'll have the MGB, I'll have my own set of mics. Honestly, if the gig is paying enough, I'll take all my mics. I'll use my own mics. That's pretty straightforward. I'll approach the production for a stage layout, venue layout. I'll, to an extent, plot where I want speaker towers, console. If it's not a wedding or a corporate, I can have access of exactly what I want. If it's a corporate or a wedding, you have to kind of use an iPad. Yeah. Cool. I think we're pretty much out of time. For anyone else who wants any particular, who wants to look at the setup and all, the setup is all down right here at this high-tech booth. We can go through the entire setup there. If you have questions on gain structure and all that, we can also approach that down there. Okay, cool, thanks guys, thanks a lot.
I would like to invite Mr. Anil Chopra, convener of the Palm Conference and director of the Palm Show, to please come up on stage and present certificate of appreciation to Mr. Fali Damania.
I want to thank Fali for his time, for his very involved, spontaneous sharing of his knowledge with you. We are very grateful to him for doing this. The Palm Show is not just a huge exhibition with all the equipment there. We look for support from people like Fali to, if I may use the word, train and develop the talent that we have in India to make intelligent buying decisions. And in this regard, I think the session we had today is really commendable. And I want all of us to applaud Fali once more. Thank you. Before I forget, I also want to thank Yamaha, who have sponsored this conference. And we are grateful to Yamaha for doing this. Thank you very much.